I venture to also suggest, such of those of you who have not had the opportunity yet, to please have a look at the documentation that you have in your folders. And there you will find an interview by given by Dr. Hans Blakes, the former Director General of the IAEA. And there's another one on Iran's nuclear program and the legal mandates of the IAEA. Both of these are very relevant to not only what Admiral Shankar has just said, but also what I do imagine that Arun Vishwanathan is going to say now. So may I please call upon him to give his presentation. Thank you.
Siddhartha, let me begin by thanking Professor Ramamurthy and Professor Rajaram and Professor Chandrasekhar for giving me this opportunity to speak here. As you see, I'll be giving an overview on the Iranian nuclear program, and I'll not be touching on the technical aspects because that is something which Dr. Krishnan will be doing in his presentation. The outline of the presentation is something like this. Begin with the current status of the P5+1 negotiations, then go on to a theoretical this thing as to what drives nuclear proliferation, and from there a brief history of the Iranian nuclear program, the main drivers as to the program, and what do these drivers tell us about Iran and how the course the program will take, the Iran and the IAEA, and how the IAEA has also seen a shift from playing Robin Hood during the Atoms for Peace to an inspector, role of an inspector, to now one possibly of a politician. Then a nuclear Iran, how will it behave? Most of the literature floating around is talking more of whether Iran will go nuclear, how quickly will it go nuclear, etc. But I'll want to look at it a little differently. Whether Iran, if it goes nuclear, how will it behave? Will it behave any differently from other states? Then a catch-22 that Iran finds itself in will be the last sort of thing in my presentation. Beginning with the current status of the P5+1 negotiations, been talked about by former speakers also. But as we know, in Baghdad, with the P5+1 and Iran and the negotiator Saeed Jalili had met in the much fortified green zone, but they did not succeed in making much progress. However, the parties have agreed to meet again on June 18th, somewhere mid-June in Moscow, for another round of negotiations. This would be the third series of meetings since Istanbul in April, when they met after that ended a 15-month hiatus in talks. Now, the West has wanted, as we have known, that they want Iran to halt the production, which they claim has reached 20% of uranium enrichment, ship this stockpile abroad, and eventually shut down the new enrichment plant at Fordo near Qom. In return, unlike what Iran would have expected, there was nothing which was put on table regarding immediate relief from any economic sanctions, and neither was there any sort of reconsideration which was promised for a EU embargo, which was also spoken about by Admiral Shankar. Now, the Iranian negotiator apparently ran circles around the P5+1, and it's supposed that he made a 5-point proposal, but he did not make any kind of written proposal during this. One was about he could have promised a fatwa from the supreme leader declaring nuclear weapons forbidden under Islam, but no mention of how this would be operationalized. Second, recognition of the Iranian right to enrich uranium under the NPT, which Iran claims is a right it has under the NPT. Second, discussion of regional issues like Syria and Bahrain, which was outrightly rejected by the P5+1, that this is not a forum for negotiating discussing any such issue. Then some kind of positive movement in the West in return for Iran agreeing to enter into an agreement with the IAEA on inspections. With the IAEA, Iran sort of only agreed that it would discuss further, meet further and on inspection. It did not enter into any sort of agreement, unlike what was said in a lot of the media reports. And probably Jalili wanted to go to Baghdad with a sort of a bargaining chip in hand. So that could be one reason why the DGIAEA went just prior to this meeting in Baghdad. And also discuss the enrichment up to 20%, but this would also be an open-ended sort of a discussion without any details as to if Iran would actually suspend enrichment and what would it demand in return if it did so. So despite the positive movement which was noted, that I wouldn't sort of describe it as a breakthrough between Iran and IAEA following the DG Yuki Amano's visit to Tehran, there is an anxiety which is quite palpable among all states in the issue as to if there is no progress which is seen and no progress is achieved in the Moscow meeting, as to what will be the future of this given Israel's drum war beating that it would like to bomb Iran. Now, what drives nuclear proliferation? I'll just go through this quickly. You can either focus on the demand side, which is the state's willingness to acquire nuclear weapons, which is sort of fashioned by the security challenges it faces. It could acquire nuclear weapons if many countries have to deter external aggression. It either domestic political lobbies, coalitions, and their associated development, economic development strategies could be another sort of factor which drives proliferation. In the international norms of prestige associated with nuclear weapons could be another factor. Or individual psychological or personality could also drive nuclear proliferation or states' acquisition of nuclear weapons. Another could be the opportunity to acquire nuclear weapons. This in essence means that a state's desire is one thing, but does it have the technology, resources and expertise to build nuclear weapons, to procure nuclear weapons? So it does not matter whether a state wants to acquire it, but if it is unable to sort of muster these elements, it cannot do so. In any of these, there will be a combination of varying degrees which any of these factors will we come together and drive a nation pursuit of sort of proliferation. I also wanted to sort of point out this thing was, when you're examining nuclear proliferation as general rule of the thumb, the spread of nuclear weapons is more threatening to relatively powerful states than it is to relatively weak ones. The state supply of sensitive nuclear resistance to other states is influenced by largely three strategic conditions. One could be the more powerful state is relative, the more the state is powerful to the recipient, the less likely it is likely to provide such assistance. States are more likely to provide such assistance to countries which they share a common enemy with. And thirdly, states which are less vulnerable to superpower pressure are more likely to provide such assistance. I'll move on to the brief history of the Iranian nuclear program. As we noted, it had a rather large nuclear program under Shah Pahlavi. In 1974, it signed several contracts with the US for supply of six reactors, West Germany 2, France 5, along with the arrangements to supply light-enriched uranium to fuel these reactors with investing in Eurodif and other long-term supply contracts with France, West Germany, and the US. They also envisioned to have a complete nuclear fuel cycle, for which Iran negotiated for acquisition of plutonium reprocessing technologies from the West Germany and some hot cells separation of PU from the US. Now, when interestingly, this ambition to achieve full fuel cycle was something of a roadblock when the US and Iran was negotiating their peaceful nuclear cooperation arrangement in 76. Interestingly, the Tehran Research Reactor, which is under a lot of controversy, was supplied by the US in 1967 when it began functioning. And subsequently, Iran entered into an agreement with Argentina to supply a new core fueled by uranium enriched up to 20%. Now, during this time, they also entered into expanding their civilian nuclear program to 1,300 megawatt nuclear reactors from Siemens, another one which was to be supplied by France. In this point of time, there were certain statements by Shah regarding Iran taking the option of producing nuclear weapons. In 1974, he made the first statement, and similar statement was made in February 1975. But all this came to an abrupt halt following the 1979 Islamic revolution. This could be one of the drivers which sort of influences Iran's progress in the current scenario. Another important driver is the 8-year long Iran-Iraq war, which definitely left a very deep impression in the Iranian psyche, and it greatly influences this pursuit of nuclear weapons today. During the course of this war, burdened with the US-led arms embargo and facing chemical weapon and Scud-type missile attacks from Iraq, Iranian leaders definitely realized the need for a strong deterrent. The Iran-Iraq war taught the Iranians a valuable lesson about the importance of having a credible deterrent force of its own. Iran, during this crisis, had none, and they were extremely vulnerable as a result of this. In October 1988, drawing upon the experience of the Iran-Iraq war, the then Speaker of Iran's Parliament, or Majlis as it's known, Hashimi Rafsanjani, spoke to the IRGC and called for the development of nuclear and other unconventional weapons. He is supposed to have said the importance of such weapons was made very clear during the war. We should fully equip ourselves both in the offensive and defensive use of chemical, biological and radiological weapons. Though he subsequently rejected nuclear weapons on many occasions, as have other leaders, calling it a completely anti-Islamic, Rafsanjani's statements captured the impact that the Iran-Iraq war had on the Iranian nuclear program and its pursuit of nuclear weapons. So next, what do these drivers tell us about Iran? On the demand side, as seen from the brief history that I just sort of outlined, there are several security challenges in the Iranian history which design Iran's security paradigm. Israel's possession of nuclear weapons, Iran's relations with the US, and the difference in treatment meted out to North Korea and Libya will definitely and have definitely factored how Iran perceives the threats to its security, and as a result, the possible benefits of possessing nuclear weapons. Another factor could be the domestic strong lobbies possibly led by the IRGC, which could be expected to push for a nuclear deterrent. However, I would like to state that such a push would definitely be tempered by statements, including from the Supreme Leader, which state that nuclear weapons are anti-Islamic. It is quite interesting to also note that it doesn't seem that the Iranian leadership still has taken the political decision to produce nuclear weapons. Producing nuclear weapons at the end of the day is a political decision. The politicians or the political leadership have to make a decision that after this, please go ahead and produce nuclear weapons. You can sort of achieve what is called the breakout capability, but the decision in essence has to be a political one. And this sentiment was recently echoed by the IDF chief, Lieutenant General Benny Gantz, in an interview to Haaretz. He opined that in his opinion, Iran has the leadership, including the Supreme Leader, has not sort of taken the political decision to produce nuclear weapons. And despite all his bluster about wiping off Israel off the world map, denying Holocaust, the Iranian president could be seen as a more flexible than others in the Iranian regime, the hardliners. And the fuel sap deal, which he sort of was involved in this, but he could not carry this through because of opposition from the Majlis, the hardline clerics. It became very clear that he could be one of the more flexible in the Iranian establishment. Thus, all this sort of proves that Iran is not speaking in one voice as far as the decision to produce nuclear weapon goes. However, the initiation of a conflict by the US or a strike by Israel could change all that. All these parties could sort of coalesce and come together as a result of any of this. The supply side, as I mentioned, will not touch too much. Dr. Krishnan will talk about this during his presentation. However, in my opinion, it does seem that Iran has the technology, resources and expertise to build nuclear weapons. The decision to do so is different. Interestingly, also the Israelis too are not speaking in one voice like the Iranians. They do realize that there is a window of opportunity which is rapidly closing for them. The bombing option pushed for by PM Netanyahu has been publicly been described by Meir Dagan, who was till recently the Mossad chief, as the stupidest idea he's ever heard. So the Israelis too are not sort of very clear, and they're not sort of that the only option to stop Iran would be the bombing option. Thus, despite its security concerns and technical know-how, the Iranian leadership seems to be vacillating on the actual decision to go ahead with the production of nuclear weapons. It is, however, sort of widely accepted that Iran is most likely inching towards a breakout capability. One could sort of distinguish whether Iran would choose to break out or sneak out, though such decisions would have their own set of problems. Iran, in all likelihood, would develop a capability to produce a weapon, and unless someone like Israel, in case it carries out the bombing, does something very stupid, it is unlikely to reach its tipping point. Now I'll come to the Iran and the IAEA. There has been a noticeable shift in the IAEA's role over years, or the past, since its inception. It has gone from playing atomic Robin Hood, where it has encouraged developed countries to share their technology under the Atom for Peace, to playing a sheriff role, where it's more emphasis on enhanced inspection, safeguard regimes, and policing civilian nuclear programs, to a new phase where it's dawning now, where it's playing a more political role. And as brought out by Admiral Shankar, this role was very clearly seen in the November 2011 report of the IAEA, where the agency released, in quotes, evidence about Iran's weapons-related activities. Now, what I would like to highlight is that this indicates a shift in the manner in which the agency, the IAEA, uses intelligence which is shared by member states with it. In the past, what the agency did was that it welcomed this intelligence but did not espouse it. It did not make itself the intelligence its own. Now, the November report, in my opinion, marks a shift in this, because the agency has compared this intelligence provided largely by the US and some other countries with the information which it already had from safeguards inspection in Iran and the information gleaned from the AQCON network. Now, what the agency seems to have done is it's put out this in the annex on the November 11, highlighting the Iranian activities that are relevant for the development of a weapon and relevant for nothing but producing a weapon. So the two sort of distinctions it has made. And it's by doing this, the agency seems to be stating that there is an overall picture of credibility, and it is sort of backing this, putting it out in its own report to the BOG and the Security Council, and added that this is something which is, this is a new intelligence it has provided. However, if one reads the report, there is very little which is new in this. Most of which is put out in the report is already been, which is known from the past. Secondly, it's most of this intelligence is something which has been gathered from the infamous laptop of death, which apparently the US provided to the IAEA. And this is something which still arouses suspicions as it had in 2005. Now, given that the agency's history of being burned due to suspect intelligence in the past, as was seen in the Iraqi import of uranium oxide from Niger, and even the earlier in 1993-94, when the agency was provided information of the Iraqi nuclear program, which also turned out to be false or forged, it could be in the IAEA's interest to tread very carefully when it is donning this new role. Nuclear Iran, how will it behave? Now, much of the warmongering which has been going on, led by Israel, is premised on the fact that Iran is an irrational actor, one which cannot be predicted, and nuclear weapons in the hands of such an actor would be very dangerous. However, Iran has been described by several top Israeli generals and intelligence officials as being a rational actor in its own way. It's not rational as how Israel sees it, or is how Israel perceives rationality, but in its own way it is rational. Despite this bluster towards Israel, Iran has shown no recklessness in its foreign policy, one. In fact, the last time Iran used force against a neighbor was over 200 years ago, in 1803, I believe, we sort of attacked Georgia. In fact, former Mossad chiefs have even stated that if Iran were to acquire few nuclear weapons, Israel would not face any additional or significant threat to its existence. The Iranian restraint, another point which I'd like to make, is the Iranian restraint in actions in the Strait of Hormuz during the 1980-88 Iran-Iraq war. This is another case in point which points to the rational actor, Iran being a rational actor. It realized that the closing the strait would be the military equivalent of cutting off its nose to spite its face. Therefore, it exercised restraint by attacking shipping primarily in the Western Gulf, closer to the Shatt al-Arab. Iran laid mines only in the UAE waters, and that too not in large numbers. Iran's activity in and around the strait were confined to intrusive ship boardings and inspections of cargo bound for Iraq. Later in the war, Iran, despite installing anti-ship cruise missile batteries at several locations facing the strait, never fired them at the traffic in the area. This does not happen even after the sort of accidental shooting down of the Iranian passenger airline in 1988 by USS Venice. Now, the above paints a picture of Iran being quite a rational actor, and this image is diametrically opposite to the one which is being portrayed in the popular imagination by the Western media. This would therefore mean that Iran would understand and appreciate the fact that the use of its nuclear weapons when it procures them under any situation would be suicidal. Thus, given the manner in which it has shaped and implemented its military and foreign policy, a nuclear Iran, despite fears to the contrary, is not likely to behave very differently from other existing nuclear weapon states. Finally, coming to the catch-22 situation that Iran finds itself, I would like to end this presentation by sort of highlighting on a problem or a question which has been sort of I'm munching over. Fact one, Iran has the capability to develop nuclear weapons, one which is sort of widely accepted. The debate is generally centered on how Iran would develop a breakout capability. Security concerns Iran does have, the concerns like Israel's possession of nuclear weapons, Iran's relations with the US, and these have the capabilities, like I brought out before, to drive Iran's pursuit of nuclear weapons. The problem, and therefore the question, is this. Iran is definitely heavily dependent on Russian and Chinese friendship to shore up itself economically and shield itself against the international diplomatic onslaught. Thus, it cannot afford to lose their support. This is sort of understood. Learning from the treatment meted out to North Korea and Libya by the international community, Tehran understands that the US-led international community has different standards for nuclear haves and have-nots. Thus, Iranian nuclear capability would be credible to deter American or Israeli action only if it possibly tests, regardless of whether such a test is successful or unsuccessful, as seen from the DPR case. But if Iran tests, it loses, not only does it lose Russian and Chinese support, it will also result in severe international recriminations and loss. And thus, a political decision will only occur if Iran feels that it is invulnerable against such pressures. So my question is the following. What does a nuclear Iran mean? Does it necessarily have to mean testing, or would something other than also would credibility demonstrate whether it's nuclear wherewithal? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Several points have arisen there. And before I ask a question which I have in my mind, is there anyone who wants to ask a question with regard to? Yes, Casey.
Just a question. Yes, yeah. You know, just two issues. One is, you said IAE was taken for a ride by the Niger document. Baradai's book brings out very clearly that IAEA straight away said that this is fake and Americans were not listening. It is Security Council which was taken for a ride, not IAEA. So there's a correction there. Secondly, don't pass. I think we tend to view Iran sentimentally as many other countries. Iran views no one sentimentally, nor should India. Therefore, to judge a country's intentions is even much more difficult than to judge individuals' intentions. Generally, a listing of whether Iran is risk-prone or risk-averse, there are three instances where they are risk-prone. There is the 19...
Casey, we'll come to the discussion where you can kindly make this very important point you're making. Yeah. But if there are any questions with regard to something you didn't understand, please ask. I mean, is there anything that he said that
I'm
you didn't...
No, I'm just contradicting a blanket...
Fair enough.
Giving of a character certificate to Iran that they are risk averse.
Good.
They are
not. Please make
there
that point.
There are instances both sides.
Indeed so. But please make that point when we come to the discussion
sure,
as a whole.
Sure.
Yeah. Okay. If there are no questions, get to the next presentation.
You had a question,
Joseph? I've forgotten my own question, so that's just as well. but it will come actually up against something that you will be, I think, saying. But I will wait for you to say it before I ask the question. Thank you very much. L.V.Krishnan, who knows everything that there is to know about technical aspects of any nuclear program, including the Iranian one.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me first of all thank NIAS, Rajaram Nagappa, and Professor Ramamurthy for the opportunity to speak to this high-powered audience. I feel a little intimidated by the knowledge that this group has, so I don't know what I'm going to be able to say and how I'm going to be able to answer. And added to that, the chairman has made a remark which makes it difficult for me to live up to it. Now, let me provide some of my own assumptions or assessments of what Iran is doing and what we understand from it. Now, an examination of Iran's actions certainly raises more questions than answers. The declared intentions are frequently seen to be at variance with reality. I'll explain that later. Perhaps some of the statements are purely for local consumption and should not be taken seriously. Ever since the birth of the Islamic Republic, it has had a difficult time. Does it perhaps cause officials to make statements to promote self-belief? Perhaps. Whatever is said and done, the annual IAEA reports provide a comprehensive picture of the current status of the various aspects of the Iranian program. This presentation of mine examines the current known capability of Iran in the context of a civilian nuclear program with a view to assess its relevance and adequacy to meet the declared intentions. Mark the statement. I am assessing the capability of Iran in the context of a civilian nuclear program because Iran has been saying that it is purely civilian. Now, I think Arun very briefly but clearly explained to you about the initial period of Iran's nuclear program. In the pre-Islamic Republic period, Iran benefited much by the Atoms for Peace program of the US. A sizable group of scientists and engineers received training abroad in nuclear science and technology. There were many with me when I was in the US. The 5-megawatt research reactor using HEU as fuel was set up with US help. US experts suggested a large nuclear power program for Iran, though they may be questioning the relevance of it now. Perhaps they were hoping for a market for US firms building reactors then. Iran wished to have all aspects of nuclear science and technology established, including, as Arun pointed out, nuclear weapons program. That was a period before the non-proliferation lobby became active, and a lab was set up in Iran to work with laser enrichment techniques and also plutonium recovery from irradiated uranium. There was no indication of uranium exploration at the time, however. Many other countries also helped. Germany actually undertook to build 2 power reactors. Now, I think Iran was flush with funds at the time and chose to buy materials and equipment off the shelf. They had a $700 million stake to get uranium from an African country and $1 billion stake in the large uranium enrichment plant being built in Europe. There was also an attempt to procure missiles from Israel. Now, the formation of the Islamic Republic led to Iran alienating the US and the West. The external links dried up. The country had to defend itself against the hostile neighbor Iraq, the brutal war that lasted nearly a decade. Arun mentioned it and cost almost 1 million lives. US openly sided with Iraq. Iran has had to face an endless sequence of sanctions, as the previous speakers mentioned. Now, Iran renewed the interest in the nuclear power reactor project after Germany withdrew from it. It was offered money back against the stake in the Eurodif enrichment plant but did not accept it. China came to Iran's rescue and set up a nuclear research center in Isfahan. I also found that the Iranian foreign minister in 1985 was reported as saying openly that the country needed nuclear weapons as a security deterrent. Arun also made a mention of it as a statement from the speaker later. Now, during the war decade, the nuclear program became dormant to some extent. When it was revived, no aspect was excluded. The expertise was perhaps there, although many who had received training in nuclear science and technology had taken on other jobs or had quit the country. But there was assistance available from new friends like Russia, Pakistan, and China. As an NPT signatory, Iran could have begun building nuclear facilities for peaceful purposes rightfully. But needless secrecy and provocative comments, particularly about Israel, raised suspicions about a quest for nuclear arms. Denials of the quest and statements to the effect that the religion of Islam does not approve of nuclear weapons have had no takers. Now, Iran's activities have come under intense scrutiny by the IAEA in four main areas. That is uranium enrichment, reprocessing, heavy water reactor, possible military dimensions. I will touch upon only the first three, not so much about the possible military dimensions, because I am only involved in the civilian nuclear program. Now, let us look at the enrichment program. There are reports that Iran, like Iraq, also considered the electromagnetic techniques for uranium enrichment at one point of time. In fact, they received some help from China in this regard. But the centrifuge process was chosen obviously because the suppliers used centrifuges and components by AQ Khan's Walmart. Then secret production, assembly, and testing of the machines began. When found out, Iran decided to go along with IAEA inspections up to a point. But a much larger plant than what Pakistan had was designed. It was not necessary for a weapons program, but apparently was made out to be a suitable cover for a civilian program. Understandably, the production, assembly, and technique activity was spread over several sites. In the very early days after the program was discovered in its infancy, IAEA stumbled upon the presence of far higher levels of enriched uranium. When the question was being discussed, there was cooperation available from Pakistan and Russia, and the IAEA was able to identify the source as the used centrifuges and components Iran had received from or through these two countries. Now, two things stand out from this. Very sensitive techniques are available that make it very difficult for Iran to fudge or attempt to destroy evidence of production of weapons-grade product. Secondly, Iran was apparently prudent enough to allow intrusive inspections in the enrichment plant to enable the claim that nuclear weapons was not the objective and that it was cooperating with the IAEA. Perhaps it was also a way of indicating that even if Iran did not test, Iran was going to be able to produce weapon-grade uranium, and therefore the enemies should watch out. Now, Iran had also received a better design of centrifuges from Pakistan that used a special type of steel, but appears to have had difficulty in indigenous manufacture. It has therefore turned to another option of using carbon composites, where it claims some degree of success, but it doesn't seem to have operationalized this kind of machine. There are a couple of pictures here. This is the picture of Natanz, where the 50,000 machines are located in one hall, and in the other hall, there is an R&D operation going on. I'm sure many of you people may have seen this before. Then these are the newer centrifuge machines that Iran claims to have produced, but I don't think these have been operationalized yet. Now, a parameter known as separative work unit is what defines the efficiency of a centrifuge in separating the fissile isotope in natural uranium from the rest. Now, the separative work unit is expressed as so many kilograms of separative work unit per year. The value for the Pakistan-supplied P1 centrifuge is reported to be a few kilogram SWU per machine. But from the operational records obtained through IAEA inspections, these are all data derived by the measurements made by the IAEA in the Cascade Hall. You find that the current crop of machines being used, with design adopted from Pakistan-supplied drawings, have poor efficiency. The last line tells you, the separative work unit has improved gradually from 0.12 to 0.54 to 0.49 to 0.77. It's much less than one. Very likely, there are problems in getting suitable materials and components to build better machines, even if the design is available. There could also be operational problems in running the current machines. When you have 50,000 machines, you don't assume that all of them are operating at the same time. There are many that would crash, you have to replace them. So I wouldn't really estimate the total production from the total number of machines. And now Iran has begun enriching uranium at a new site in a place called Fordow near the city of Qom. Now, it is this which has given rise to concern that maybe weapon-grade enrichment would be undertaken at this site using the partially enriched uranium from here. Now, I mentioned about the SWU of machines. Now, advanced machines today have an efficiency of a few hundred SWU per machine, mainly in the US. These have been developed mainly in the US. The previous generations had something like a few tens of SWU per machine. Vintage machines were capable of a few SWU per machine, but Iran has not been even able to get to that point. Now, with the capacity of the centrifuges now in use, it would be difficult to meet the requirements of Boucher reactor without significant expansion. Now, in the recent past, there were statements made that Iran could build 10 to 12 enrichment plants. Now, is that an indication that they are trying to expand so that they can meet the requirements of Boucher reactor? But let us also remember that Russia, which has rebuilt Boucher, by the way, I think that has been a magnificent achievement by the Russians, the way they have picked up a reactor which was mothballed over a long period of time and had suffered some damage, and they have brought in their own technology and integrated it with the German technology. That is by the way. Now, Russia has offered to supply fuel for the reactor for the first 10 years and take it back. So where is the hurry for Iran to produce enrichment or enriched uranium for the Boucher reactor? Now, another unexplained thing is that during the 1970s, laser techniques were being investigated as a means of enriching uranium. The technique works with atoms of uranium vaporized from the metal surface. That is why it is called atomic vapor laser isotope separation. Now, the project was suspended in the US in 1999 after they had come up to a certain stage. The technique is today used only for enrichment of small quantities of various other isotopes. In Iran, the laser techniques were part of the program planned during the Shah regime, as was mentioned before. Later in 1991, Iran also obtained from China some related equipment for this technique. No country now is pursuing this technique for uranium enrichment. So it comes as a surprise to learn that Iran had concluded an agreement with Russia in 1998 for information on the process and supply of equipment for this technique. Was there in 1998 a lack of confidence in the centrifuge technique? Perhaps. Now, Iran has actually claimed to the IAEA sometime in the May of 2003 that it had stopped laser work, but by then it had succeeded in producing small quantities of LEU using the laser technique, something like 3%, and later said average of 8 to 9% and maximum of 15%. But the rate of production was very small, a few milligrams per day. Actually, IAEA inspections indicate that maybe this was higher at something like 1 gram per hour, but still, it is too low a rate for feeding a reactor. But the fact is that Iran has allowed IAEA inspections into the laboratory, Nevertheless, this has stoked suspicions of a possible use of the technique for enriching lithium-6 isotope used in fusion devices. Maybe you can go on, of course, imagining many things. Now, although Iran had thought of a nuclear power program very early, indigenous uranium resource was discovered much later. Even if Iran mastered the centrifuge technique, it is not so well endowed with in uranium resources for feeding a program of light water reactors. Something like 6,000 to 7,000 megawatts is what is being mentioned. A former official of the Atomic Energy Organization of Iran had said Iran had 3,000 tons of uranium. Now, recently a site at Sagand was investigated. It was supposed to have only 533 parts per million in the uranium ore, which amounts to something like 842 tons of uranium overall. Of course, there are some other mines being investigated. Bandar Abbas is another mine. Now, overall, it doesn't seem as though Iran has sufficient uranium. Now, the Bushehr reactor requires 70 tons of LEU in the core. Lifetime needs of natural uranium work out to about 7,000 tons for the Bushehr reactor. Iran may have the indigenous capability to enrich uranium to fuel power reactors. Does it have enough uranium even for one reactor? Oh, this is a picture of the Bandar Abbas uranium mine. Now let's come to the reactors part. The 5-megawatt reactor that I mentioned earlier, built by the US, Arun also mentioned about it, during the Shah regime, it initially used HEU, and later it had to be converted to LEU. The LEU was provided at the time by Argentina. Now, Iran has also a few critical facilities built with the help of China, but mainly for experimental purposes. These reactors produce no useful power. At best, they can help in perhaps reactor physics calculations. Initially, the Tehran research reactor was fueled, as I said, with HEU. Now, Tehran claims that it has begun to produce 20% LEU for continued use of the reactor. Right now, the reactor doesn't seem to be operating continuously. It operates only intermittently and not at the full power, 5 megawatts. And the fuel life is coming to an end, so Iran does not want to go to Argentina again. So production of 20% enrichment uranium possibly can be justified if it wants to continue to operate this reactor. But Iran also claims that one of the reasons for its desire to continue to operate this reactor is to produce technetium isotopes for medical applications. Now, this technetium isotope is produced actually by irradiating highly enriched uranium in a reactor of this kind. I think it is being produced only in 5 countries in the world. In fact, there was a shutdown for a long period of a Canadian reactor which produces this isotope in very large quantity. Therefore, there was some worry about the availability of this isotope for application in the whole world. Now, actually, again, aside, the US sends 25 kg of highly weapon-grade uranium to Canada every year for irradiation to produce this isotope. A part of it only is burnt up, the rest of it is discarded as waste in a solution. Now, what it means is that if Iran wants to produce technetium isotopes, it will have to produce high-grade enrichment of uranium. It is possible to also do with low enrichment uranium, but your specific activity is not very good. Now, Iran claims that if it has to import this, then by the time it reaches the Iranian shores, the activity goes down. And it also has to pay a lot of money for it. So this probably is a valid point, but then we don't know whether Iran has reached the stage of producing weapon-grade or high enrichment uranium for this purpose. Now, there is another question that also comes up about the reactor program. The plan to build a reactor at a different site called Arak, a 40-megawatt reactor known as IR-40, this has been questioned. Because Iran says that it is going to be used for training O&M personnel in power reactors for isotope production, also for new designs of reactors that Iran may be contemplating. The details are not very clear. The details have not been given to the IAEA. IAEA is allowed to go and visit the place, but it doesn't have the design details. There are also some hot cells that are supposed to come up, but Iran claims that they do not yet have their design finalized because they don't know what kind of shielding window they will be able to get, what kind of manipulators they will be able to get. So they have held up the design of the hot cells. Now, the design of the reactor itself, from whatever information can be pieced together, seems to be a kind of a puzzle. It is a natural uranium oxide fuel. Mind you, I think Cyrus and Dhruva use metal. But zircaloy cladding, these use aluminum cladding. It is heavy water moderated, perhaps it is light water cooled. Fuel assembly, however, is similar to the RBMK reactor of the Russians. There is a picture here which clearly tells you that it has resemblance to the RBMK reactors. No, that's the kind of reactor that they had in Chernobyl, but no comparison with Chernobyl. So what exactly is Iran trying to do in this case? It's not very clear. Now, this is the site where the IR-40 reactor is being built. The dome that you see in the center, that is supposed to be the reactor building. There is another aspect that has caught the attention of the Western countries and IAEA, which is that at some point of time earlier, Iran attempted to produce polonium by irradiating bismuth. But what it was trying to do was leading to production of a very low rate, something like 150 micrograms per day. Now, polonium has a high heat generation rate, and therefore it has also been used as a source of heat in spacecraft, or even as a source of heat for direct conversion to electricity in radioisotopic thermoelectric generators, as they are called. Actually, the Russians have used it in their lunar core. But it has a short half-life, therefore it is not going to be of interest in long missions. Now, Iran gave a very different reason for this polonium project. It said it is going to develop RTGs. For what purpose? It's not very clear. Now, RTGs also require gram-level quantities, but Iran was producing, or actually it was attempting to produce, very low level of this activity. And in any case, polonium is not being used anywhere in the world anymore because plutonium-238 is being used in the Western countries which have this spacecraft. Now, more common use today for polonium is in static eliminators. But Iran did not give this as a reason. It could have passed off perhaps as an understandable reason. But of course, because of the short half-life, it has to be replenished periodically. Now, the question is, was Iran attempting to produce an initiator for use in a nuclear device? So that is what is making the West worry their minds about. Now, there is another aspect totally different from the nuclear program as such, but the international aspect of it. Now, any country which has a power reactor or which has an ambition for a large program of nuclear power reactors cooperates with other countries to ensure that there is safety given a high priority. And you learn from your experience as well as other people's experience. Now, Iran is a party to NPT. Yes, we all know that. Iran has not signed the CTBT yet. It has signed, perhaps not ratified. Now, Iran is not a party to the Convention on Nuclear Safety of IAEA or to the Convention on the Physical Protection of Nuclear Material or to the amendments to the Convention on the Physical Protection of Nuclear Material. Of course, this comes only if you have signed the first one. Or to the Joint Convention on Safety of Spent Fuel Management and on Safety of Radioactive Waste Management. It has not signed the Vienna Convention on Civil Liability for Nuclear Damage. Mind you, Bushehr is right on the coast. And if something happens there, it's possible that some radioactivity spread would be across the border into other countries. it has not signed the joint protocol relating to application of Vienna Convention and Paris Convention, or the Convention on Supplementary Compensation for Nuclear Damage. So what exactly is in Iran's mind? I think this is a puzzle that we can contemplate over for days on end, but I don't think an answer is easily available. Thank you. That's what I wanted to share with you. Thank you.
Thank you very, very much, L.V. Okay, so we are
running ahead of time
a little bit, provided you don't ask too many questions, and we can have lunch right away. Well, never mind. I propose to, by the way, any specific questions to, question. Yes.
The centrifuges you showed in the photograph are supercritical maraging steel centrifuges. The one with the president. It cannot be, no, I'll tell you why. It cannot be the carbon composite one because of the fact that the cooling channels are all maintained on the round on this one through. And also the reflection and the light reflection of a composite one is vastly different.
No,
and the second one, the other question is, if I remember right, if a implosion in the case of very highly enriched uranium, the design is different from that of plutonium. I shall remain at that. I don't want to talk more.
Would you like to clarify the point about the fact that you were showing the cover of that thing and not the insides of it?
Yeah, I think the rotor is inside this vacuum chamber. This is a vacuum chamber.
Yes.
Of course, you may have a point there that it has these cooling coils around, and maybe the cooling coils are not required for carbon composites. I'm not sure about that.
Okay. Any other questions? Yes.
Thank you. I am a little confused, and please correct me if I'm wrong. The simple picture Iran puts out, and you also mentioned, 20% enrichment is required for the research reactor, not for the power reactor. I thought you said they don't have enough uranium to fuel Bushehr. Bushehr is under supply arrangements with the Russians. They're not targeting, or at least have not said. So why bring that in that context? 20% enrichment for research reactor is needed, and you yourself said it's functioning only intermittently. They don't have an assured supply source, and in any case, it's a matter of choice whether you want to import or make your own. So does anything, I am not very sure if you said something which contradicts that simple picture that is what we have taken on the basis of Iranian justifications to prevail. I thought you said that, you know, they don't have enough uranium to manufacture for Bushehr, fuel for Bushehr. They don't need to, no? They only need to focus on the research reactor fuel, which is what involves highly enriched uranium, which they may not get.
It seems to me the contradiction is actually in the various statements being made by Iran. Because at one point of time, Iran said that we can export enriched uranium for power reactor programs in other countries. Yes. What you say is correct, that 20% is probably for the research reactor, right? And even higher levels of enrichment could be for irradiation in this research reactor to produce isotopes. But they did make this claim. So the contradiction actually comes from the statements that are being made in Iran at various points of time, not in your mind.
Santana.
Point one, the fall of the Shah of Iran led to a complete, enormous collapse of all aspects of nuclear cooperation between Brazil and Iran. You know, Brazil, we are forgetting. It was massive, it was wide-ranging. So the fall of the Shah of Iran led to that particular collapse. Initially, Khomeini, the senior, as president, supported this collapse of the regime because they were anti-nuclear to begin with. And in the process, Iran lost forever, the support they could get from Brazil. In my opinion, Iran's nuclear arbitrations are gone, dead, gone, RIP, thanks to RIP, I stands for Israel. Some help may come from Russia through the two reactors, Bushehr 1 and Bushehr 2, but these are likely to be under full safeguards, so no difficulty at all. Nuclear manpower, major problem. Whatever manpower they had trained in Europe as well as USA, these souls have departed, so there's an enormous manpower difficulty. AQ Khan tried his overtures, they have failed. But I would like to add up with one sentence. This threat of Iran is kept alive by the Israeli lobby. Thank you.
That was a comment. Thank you, Santi. You want to make an observation on that point?
Yeah. About manpower.
There are three people, okay, any more questions with regard to the presentation that was made by L.V. Krishnan? Only question.
No, we'll
come to the comment.
If it's a question that you didn't understand.
No, then the comment will get left behind.
No, they're coming for comments as a whole.
But we'll miss them out then, because when the whole thing is put together, it'll get...
Okay.
Sit down. Is there a question or a comment?
This is just a Polonium.
No. Okay. 1 minute.
Thank you.
Yeah, we'll
come to those questions because they've been structured in a particular way, or I'm intending to do that. There's a question.
Please ask. And sort of semi prerogative. If there's anyone in there are three people in this room who know about the visit of Setna to Iran. Is anybody wanting to clarify on that point? The three people in this room who know about it. When Setna was asked by Indira Gandhi to go and talk to the Iranians, nobody wants to say anything. Okay, fair enough.
Okay.
Discussion with the questions in the following way. One is on capabilities, one is on intentions, I'm talking about Iran, and the thirdly is the likely actions of Iran in the scenario building that we're doing. On all these categories, we'll take the questions. And if you can focus on that particular lot that you are trying to, that is on capabilities, on intentions, and likely actions. On capabilities of Iran, are there any questions? And we can have then discussion totally on the capabilities issue only for the moment. Anyone? Yeah.
Thank you, Doctor, very much for this SWU per machine. Just one comment that you find a dip in 2009, it's come to 0.49. Was it the Stuxnet virus? Because that was hitting the machines, even the Iranians have conceded it. Because you find suddenly a dip and then going up. Normally the dip shouldn't be there. I thought that's an interesting.
It could well be, it's difficult to say, but it could also be that the cascade was operated in a particular manner and they probably also had problems with UF6 quality. So there are many different factors that could probably be attributed to this. Stuckness could also be a factor, but I do not know whether that was indeed the factor.
Santi, could I instigate you to ask a question?
Yeah. This is a question.
Yeah, let me ask you one first, or rather ask you to ask one first. Do we know from this, I mean, or what you did earlier, whether there was in fact a power shortage? Please carry on with your question. Okay.
My question is to Professor. Sorry, got it? Yeah. You mentioned polonium, but then you cannot have polonium alone. You need beryllium. Where do they get beryllium from?
Answer.
There are reports that they have got samples of beryllium, but I do not know the quantity. That quantity, of course, is not known to anybody. But there are indications that they had also obtained some beryllium. Yes.
Is something that I think we have to ask.
And since there are any number of people here with at least the knowledge, if not necessarily giving the answers. In any case, in a gun device, you probably don't need it. I'm not sure about this. Or the beryllium, I mean. I'm not talking about the polonium.
The beryllium. The beryllium
polonium is a combination that provides a shower of neutrons for explosion.
But this is definitely needed in the case of plutonium because it doesn't have the required shower. But in the case of uranium, I doubt whether polonium was needed for this, but I am not sure. One wanted to be doubly sure, perhaps. The other question which L.V.K. didn't touch is, if we are going for an implosion structure, which it, I think in case they were planning, the rest of the structures, the high energy explosion coming on the triggering at the right time, etc., I thought that it's fairly easy for the Iranians to manufacture. It is not a beyond this one. In that case, the only the critical element would be only availability of U-235 in the required amount. But the rest of things, if they think that the Iranians can't do that, it's wrong. They can do that fairly effortlessly.
Is there anyone who wants to say anything at all about gun devices for a first test with the enrichment levels that are presumed to have been reached in the quantities that are presumed to have been reached? Santi?
If it is weapons-grade plutonium, where the... No, I'll start with plutonium.
The question was on uranium. No, or you want to answer his question?
To that. If you have plutonium-240 less than 15% or 20%, you can do without it. But in the case of a classical uranium device, you don't need that.
Okay, so in a classical gun-type uranium device, you wouldn't need that, right?
No, both sides.
Both sides.
The gun device has been abandoned all over
the world. No, for the purposes of demonstration only. For the purposes of political demonstration by the Iranians only, not for any other purpose, a gun device doesn't, in any case, the first one wasn't tested. I mean, the very first one, which was dropped, wasn't tested.
I think the Iranian capability is higher than estimated.
Okay. Iranian capability higher than estimated. Anybody else make a comment on that? Yeah.
I think from what we know, it is most likely that the Iranian program is based on the implosion device rather than the gun device.
Okay, an important point that the Iranians would be going for. All right, is there anyone on the capabilities question? We're still on the capabilities issue. We'll get down to the next one immediately after. Capabilities, physics, technology, polonium. Okay, done. Let's now get down to intentions. Anyone want to talk about or ask questions with regard to Iranian intentions, which gets to the larger issue? Yeah, please.
On the end, well, I just want to make a comment on, if I may, on presentation, yes. If I may,
yes.
That he said that the last time that Iran attacked another nation neighbor was 200 years ago, and apparently on Georgia. I just wanted to say that, actually that is the time that the great game has started, and then the Russians are advancing down to confront the British in India, the advancement. And after the 16th century onward, that is the time that Iran is reduced to today's geographical fact. After the that is the only time that in the new era Iran has confrontation, and that was with Ottoman Empire. After that, 1823 onward, which Iran is reducing to its today's geographical borders, Iran actually has not dared even to attack any other nation. Thank you.
Thank you for that comment. You might like to note that as from a historical perspective. Anyway, still now on the issue of intentions after all of this discussion. Anyone talking about Iranian intentions? Casey.
It's always dicey to calculate intentions. That's what I think intelligence agencies, political systems calculate all the time and often get wrong. in case of Iran, I just wanted to make that point that risk averse, four times Iran has shown that they are risk averse. 91, when there was a Shia uprising in Iraq, they refused to go to their rescue. Otherwise, they might have been a different outcome. 1998, when the Taliban annexed Mazar-e-Sharif and started massacring their diplomats as well as the Shias, they didn't go to their rescue, just went up to the border, threatened them. 2006, when Israel attacked and Hezbollah were at it, probably they didn't need to go to their aid. And 2011 is Bahrain. So which means Iran has also done it subtly. They do it through surrogates. They prefer to do it through surrogates, and we should not lose sight of it. Just because they haven't done it directly, it doesn't mean the intent is not there. Now, thrice they have done it. They rejected a ceasefire when they crossed over into the Fao Peninsula in 1982. They would have settled the war on their terms, exactly the terms they settled on, even better terms than 89, if they had settled in 82, but they refused to. 96, Khobar Towers attack. They had outsourced to Hezbollah, blew up the Americans in Saudi Arabia. The Saudis determined an Iranian footprint, didn't tell the Americans. And 2012, the blast in Delhi, Thailand, and in the Caucasus, where there is an Iranian, obviously an Iranian footprint, whether there's a government connection or not, but clearly there's an Iranian footprint. So we must not just take the Iranian overt actions. There is the proclivity to work covertly and with surrogates. And therefore, there is, and dissimilitude and taqiyya is a part of the Iranian functioning. Even when, just to contradict a friend here, Nader Shah is the last one to attack, which would be 18th century, when he marched to Delhi and looted the treasury. And his letter from Kandahar was very interesting. When he wrote to his supposed brotherly prince in Delhi, he said, "I am in these lands of yours. I find them very salubrious and good for hunting. I think I will keep them." So he was gradually pressing along, seeing how much resistance there is. So Iranian traditional technique is of subtle two steps forward, one back, risk averse to the point of not anything causing them loss, but if they can gain something through negotiation, and gradually they will. So it is a creeping thing which they are demonstrating. Thank you.
That's an interesting comment with regard to the psych. Excuse me, one moment. Sorry, any questions? That on Casey's point, anybody on Casey's point, we're still on that point, about the psychology of creeping negotiations. Yes.
Actually, last week there was a report that a U.S. ship captured by the Somali pirates was rescued by the Iranians, and the Russians, actually, Americans thanked them. So the question is, what is the on the question of intentions, exactly as Casey pointed out. Are they going on a full hog? Are they show this kinds of contradictory behavior?
Any answer to that?
That's typically, like any country with traditionally, there's nothing wrong with that. Many countries do that. Dissimilitude is part of your, but in case of Iran, it has theological justification. Dissimilitude is not just resting in real politics and diplomacy. It has in Shia theology a justification given to dissimilitude, okay, which is taqiyya.
All right. Now, this would you characterize this as dissimilitude? The action that has been taken with regard to the rescue of the of the Somali pirates, is dissimilitude in order to convey what?
No, this is image management.
Okay. Anybody else on the question, and specifically on that? On intentions, Iranian intentions. Okay, we now move to. Sorry, carry on, please.
There's a very strong perception in West Asia that the nuclear asymmetry between Israel and the rest of the West Asian states is very high, very acute, and has to be eliminated. How they proceed to do it will be through ways devious and non-devious, but the thrust is still there. One way would be to denuclearize partly, if not fully, Israel's nuclear capability. Okay, inshallah, bless apart. So given this particular intention, if not today, if not tomorrow, they will catch up.
Who will catch up what? Can you clarify that?
Yeah,
Anyone on intentions? Or on a comment on, yes.
No, I have nothing to say, but I was hoping we'd hear something from our Iranian friend on this question, where you hear, you read so much in the international media, motivated, of course, the kinds of activities that have been attributed, and not just, I mean, media comes from like IAEA report and so on. Surely you would like to tell us something on those things?
Well, when it comes for my presentation, I hope there, right after my presentation, you can pose your question. I will be in your service.
Good. Thank you. If that completes intentions, we go on to the last one before lunch. Likely actions, both on the side of all actors which have been mentioned here. What are those likely actions on the basis of the capabilities that you and intentions that we've talked about right now? Anybody who wants to talk about likely actions on the side of Iran, US, et cetera, Israel, and so on. Yeah, Casey. No, I'm asking, is there anyone who wants to make a comment now, not make a presentation, on what has been heard so far and any conclusions with regard to likely actions? Of course, that there'd be a huge discussion. Yes.
It takes two to play to fight a war, and the ability to predict as to what sort of a response is going to come across, we've always got it wrong. We've always got it wrong. And therefore, while one side may like to limit their actions and do a surgical strike to remove the nuclear capability, it would be very naive to believe that that's the end of it. Yes. When dealing with some of the other, you know, West Asian countries, maybe it could have been, as it was in the case of Iraq. But we've always taken the stand that Iran is not like the other West Asian countries. And I couldn't help underscoring this weapon of despair. You may actually see a spurt in terrorist activities if such footprint now. If that happens, then the war is not limited. It's like saying that, oh, Afghanistan is a limited war. But the threat of carrying that action into every country in the world just enlarged. So to that extent, these differentiations don't make too much sense. After all, limited war and unlimited war were ideas. Again, Clausewitz's ideas, where he said that here is annihilation or nothing, you know, that was unlimited. Well, limited was, you know, you could limit it because your aims are limited. But the aims on both sides are very different.
Casey?
Just for your knowledge, March 19, there was a war game. It's called Internal Look, which US conducted. Probably you Google it, you'll get it. Internal Look, which did a scenario where they said whether Israel starts it, or US starts it, US will get sucked in. And their estimate is that Israel by itself, if it attacks with its capability, though there was a think tanker from Israel the other day in Delhi, and he said Israel's capability is underestimated. But American estimate is that they can delay the program by 1 year. You cannot eliminate knowledge. You can eliminate physical facilities which can be rebuilt, and there might be a portion which is not known. And it's not a single OSIRAQ, it's multi-featured, as we have seen, and there are many facilities, and there may be duplicates. That is part of Iranian ability to function. US, they said, if it goes after them, can delay it by 2 years unless they nuke them, which they obviously can't. So in terms of conventional attack, this is what this particular exercise did. Brzezinski, in a book, recent book called Strategic Vision, he talks of the constraints. He said, what is it that can precipitate US decline? Decline there is at the moment, but what can precipitate it? And he puts three factors, and one of them is another destructive war. So basically, US thinkers don't want a war.
And finally, whether it can be now or not, don't forget that Israel just had a unity government. So they have, he's closed ranks with his opponents. And the same think tanker said, there's very little noise coming out of Israel. They said Israel is the most dangerous when it's all quiet. There is no debate. So it's basically, we can leave it there.
Thank you, Casey, very much. That actually wraps up all three, your capabilities, intentions, and likely actions together. Is a question or a comment? Yeah, please.
You see, since the conclusion of the Second World War, U.S. is having predatory militarism for maintaining its dominance on the oil supplies. And it has carried on this aspect since then. We have seen various speakers have said about the their experience in Afghanistan, their onslaught on Iraq, and perhaps the template that people are thinking about is being prepared on the Iraqi scenario, that these all these excuses are being invented, that they are developing nuclear bombs, etc., and the ultimate aim of attacking Iran to maintain this oil supremacy. Now, that was in 2003, Iraq template. Now we are in 2012, where the hunger for oil is increasing day by day, and there is a competition from China and Soviet Union, and Russia, I would say. Now, there is a scenario as on today that there is a reduction in 2% of the extraction per annum, whereas the need is increasing by 3%. That means there is going to be overall shortage of oil at the rate of 5% in the succeeding years. And the requirement of all the countries is increasing, and there is an outreach from China, even from India, even from Russia, to go to far lands to negotiate for oils. Now, in such a scenario, all these powers, Russia particularly and China, they are also nuclear powers. Now, if America extends its imperialistic designs, as it has been doing for the last 50, 60 years, history tells us that ultimately all the imperialist army have got certain limitations, and if they extend beyond a particular stress point, then the collapse takes place. Now, with the scenario that is developing here, now the reason for this deterrence will come from these two countries, that is China and Russia, because they will not leave that supremacy should entirely pass on to US, otherwise their own economic development will come to a standstill. Now, for this purpose, that is why I somehow feel that these negotiations which are taking place, and they have been extended to 18th June now, on this onwards, there are two-pronged policy being adopted. One is to keep on extending around the table so that people can be weathered down, beaten down by the negotiations and international pressure. And the US, the Russia and China will not come in direct confrontation, unlikely to come. And so is America is not likely to come to in direct confrontation with these two countries. So there will be continuous, a prolonged roundtable discussions rather than the immediate shooting out war. Though the proxy war has, the covert actions have started, the people are being sabotaged, there is cyber war, there is all sorts of this thing. But ultimately shooting war may not be a distant, may be a distant possibility only. Thank you.
Thank you, Sultana. Casey, any point, comment you want to make on that?
You see, I think it's a little different. Estimates are because of shale gas in US, their dependence on imported oil is diminishing. In fact, rapidly diminishing as far as the Gulf is concerned. Some estimates are that by 2020, they would not need to import oil and definitely not from the Gulf. So they'll wean themselves away from Gulf in the next 4 or 5 years. Secondly, Russia has a reverse argument. Russia would not want peace in the area because the oil prices drop. And that is the single commodity keeping Russia afloat. It's still an oil and gas-based economy. So they want to stoke it because any peace, oil price coming down, brings the Iranian, if you oil is down to $50 a barrel, the Saudi ruling family, the Iranian Islamic regime, and Putin's government are all vulnerable to oil at 50. So they are contrary trends. There's no single trend. They're contrary trends taking place.
Interesting point about contrary trends. Yeah. Sold
just on. One point I will just mention about the dependency of U.S. Getting reduced on the Gulf oil. Now, recent figures indicate that the Saudi Arabians increase in production at the instance of USA Mostly it has benefited the refinery which is coming up in Texas, if I remember the name, Motiva. It is actually feeding, becoming a feedstock, excess production being made by Saudi Arabia is becoming a feedstock for USA. Now, dependence upon shale or whether, whatever may be the prospects of USA getting bigger exploitation within their own shores, the fact remains that they are only having roughly 2 to 3% of the total oil reserves of the world. And their consumption is 26% and always going to increase. And when they engage in war, actually they have to build reserves. Because once they engaged into war, their consumption of petrol went up to 3.5 million gallons in Afghanistan war. And some estimates say that 16 gallons per soldier were spent every day for fighting that type of war. Now, if they don't build up exact reserve or continue to maintain the dominance, they will actually be shortchanging their own air force, which is the biggest consumer of USA. That their own consumption is 300,000 barrels per day. So it is for them, it is not only to keep pace with maintaining their own balance and the reserves. Actually, they have already touched upon the reserves, US, for maintaining supplies to UK. Because once this type of thing happens, the question is whether they would like to disrupt the supplies from Iran to, after going to war. And of course, there will be disruption of supplies from other countries as well.
Yeah, comment on that?
Yeah, actually, I agree with KC. The thing is that US has reversed its declining production just after 2007. In fact, you find that the increase in their oil production from 2007, just not gas, is equivalent to that of Ecuador's production, which is an OECD member. Now, if you look at the case of natural gas, the price within US is $2.5 a million BTU, while around the world is $16 a million BTU. And by 2025, 2030, North America is energy independent. And they are not, and you have huge finds in Brazil offshore. You have a lot of things which are done in US, especially Alaska, and the Keystone pipeline, which is there today, which is the biggest problem because there's a problem of refining the crudes in the East Coast because they have to really see that there's a proper pipeline from Flushing. And these are questions which they will be able to solve. 2005, Bush said, America is actually oil addicted. Today you find that they are on a path to energy independence. And that's the point which you have to note. And they have lost least stakes with respect to hydrocarbon potential in the Gulf or with Iran or whatever be the case. So this is the scenario which you have to take because all of us are taking this based on pre-2007 figures.
Can I, on that point, particular point, does that enhance the likelihood of, in fact, a clobbering of Iran, because if they are less and less dependent, they wouldn't give a damn about what other people are dependent on.
This is where I go with KC.
What would be your particular assessment?
This is where I will go with KC, because high oil prices are the ones which keep these regimes in Russia, in Iran, as well as in these countries, Saudi Arabia, to go on. Unless you have the high prices, their economies will collapse. And that's the question we'll have to really debate here, rather than the question of only the US being acting. Second question, we talk about, you know, the China, and India is buckling to the sanctions. It's not so. You look at the China, they have cut down their dependence of Iranian oil by 50%. So if you look at from that point of view, surely we'll have to see that there is a thing which globally, there's a way of getting Iran isolated, but we have to see exactly how it affects us because we are more vulnerable.
That last point taken, but on the question, if I may ask Casey this, what is your assessment that as a result of the semi-independence or the moving towards independence or moving towards less dependence on Iranian oil by other countries, and in particular the United States through all this, what we've just heard, is the likelihood of a war being conducted on the present regime on Iran higher or lower?
Well, we'll discuss it in detail tomorrow. I mean, this you can build an argument either way. We'll have to look at the reasons rather than... It's very difficult to come to a conclusion. Right. And sometimes things happen accidentally.
All right.
It's not because...
Okay. Point taken. We'll wait until tomorrow.
Just that, one of my slides mentioned this, that the object of weaning oneself away from Iranian oil is twofold. One is a consequence... But the first is to take prophylactic action. I mean, I don't want to find myself in a situation where I'm not where I'm not exactly starved, but certainly my energy supplies are disrupted. Now you can see, why is it that Iraq production and Libyan production has gone to EU? I mean, it's pretty straightforward. The equation there is pretty clear. Whatever the EU is getting from Iran is being substituted. Now you may say it's prophylactic. You may say now we are squeezing Iran. I think both are happening. One, a consequence, but the first act is prophylactic. Thank you.
See, Iran's relevance to US approaches to the whole area is not just oil-based. It's at the moment what's happening between the Shia Crescent and the Sunni Crescent and Arab Spring. And that is why US, for the first time, sacrificed a close ally, Mubarak, which the Saudis could never understand. Obama let it happen. It's the first time in their history you let a close ally go to the street, or sacrificed at the altar of the street. Because they realized if you have to counter radical Islam, then you have to be seen as allowing people to express themselves and allowing orderly change through non-violent means. Otherwise, you're going into the Al-Qaeda narrative. So the two narratives are very, very important for stabilizing the entire Islamic world. And Iran plays the spoiler there, because Iran, because of US intervention, two of Iran's enemies got eliminated, the Taliban in Afghanistan and Saddam Hussein in Iraq. And in the process, they opened the corridor for Iran now to have an influence all the way through Iraq, through the Alawites in Syria, to the Hezbollah. It's like the Achaemenid Empire of the 5th century. Their influence is running all the way from Pakistan's border to the Mediterranean. How do you counter that? And it's conflicting the Sunni world in Syria, in Bahrain, in Yemen.
Maybe this you can address tomorrow if I might ask the question now, but I'm not expecting the answer. No. The question, why should anyone bother about it? I mean, why shouldn't there be a Shia resurgence? That you can answer tomorrow. I mean, might be the consequences?
Very simply, it's rooted because there's terrorism. It's feeding the terrorism in the place, and that's affecting the Western world.
Well, not necessarily, but anyway, we'll come to that tomorrow.
Anyone else?
On essentially technical questions which were discussed today. And consequences. Yeah, please.
I had a question to a point which Dr. Santanam had made regarding the degradation of Iranian manpower. I was more interested in knowing as to what would be the general kind of numbers as to for operating a sort of a nuclear program or a military program, for instance. Any estimates or?
You can just extrapolate from our own, because we are overmanned by a pack capacity of 2,700%. So, I mean, that's very easy to do, but never mind. Please, kindly. Yeah.
Just to Ambassador Singh saying that America sacrificed Mubarak. I think, sir, at the time, really, Americans and Europeans, they couldn't know how to behave. I think it was due to the scale of the uprisings in the North Africa and Middle East. To my understanding, if really they could manage, they would have prevented that. It is not that, and that is my main critique to the liberalism, democracy, when it turns to be biased. You know, living now recently after experiencing Iran and India and living in the West, I see that. Of course, to me, liberalism and democracy, that is the ideal form of governing, but it is all relative. So to make it short, I think if Americans, if EU, could they really couldn't do much. That's why they, you know, you had one after another. In the history, we don't have, as far as I know, the six revolts which happened in the Arab countries. It has been never like in the history. So I think if they couldn't, you know, prevent it, it was not a choice for Americans and Europeans, I guess.
So
thank you.
What you're saying is avalanche revolutions are intrinsic to the present situation because of the information revolution. Okay, good. Anyone else on avalanche revolutions? No. Good, but then on avalanches alone, and I suppose lunch, after a period of time. What time is lunch? Okay, so we're ahead of time, all of half an hour. Thank you all very much indeed. Thank you for...
General suggestion, we start a bit early because most of us are here. Let's start. I request Ambassador Singh to moderate the next three papers. I'll come back here, I think, as soon as Ambassador Singh makes his remarks, opening remarks. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. I was the one asking for early start and got my papers mixed up while I was gossiping about Arnab Goswami. I think we had a very productive forenoon session with the issues spilling over, and that's how a roundtable is. So some of what we are going to discuss now probably in parts got discussed earlier, and that is how the issue advances. I think it was very productive, very healthy discussion we had in the morning. I will be a little less dictatorial than the last chairman. So I think what we'll do will be a little more flexible. We'll see, we'll play, as I say, play by the ear as we go along. So why don't we, without further ado, start with, this is essentially an expert thing, except the last one where we have an Iranian friend. And essential to this is capability. In fact, what is talked about China, what the Americans always say in their review, is that it is not the intentions of China, it is the capability. That when you look at other countries, you look at their capability. And from the capability, the intentions can change or can float from one to the other, but the capability is permanent. So the missile capability, one of the things which IAEA also raised was experiments with a re-entry, which is what gave you some sense of why are they experimenting with re-entry vehicles or the shape of the cone, etc., because that may give you some insight into what they want to put on top of the missile. So then I think we go to our experts and have them throw some light on it. So let's start straight away with Professor Nagappa.
Thank you, Ambassador Singh. We'll get started now. My colleague Chandra is a part of this today. It'll take time, is it? Yeah. So I'll make the presentation, and hopefully if there's some questions which he could answer, I'll try my best to answer. The Iran missile capabilities are fairly of recent origin, I should say. They may have had during the Shah's regime mostly procured missiles, mainly the for the air defense as well as the aircraft mounted this one. But I think bulk of it was unserviceable afterwards. And it's only the post-Iranian revolution when they saw it, they really started getting into it. And perhaps the catalyst was the Iran-Iraq war. Their own capability really didn't surface because one is, many of the experts had already gone off to the West, and both technology and materials, with the tightening regimes all over like MTCR and other regulatory regimes, availability itself was a bit of a problem. And when you are short of stores and working with the cannibalized aircraft, the Iran-Iraq war really brought home the necessity of the ballistic missiles. And what Iran seems to have done is gone for outside procurement, done a little bit of re-engineering, and also in the process developed indigenous capabilities. I will show towards the end, in fact, in some of these capabilities, they have excelled even Pakistan today. So Iran at the time had essentially artillery rockets, 30 kilometers, 40 kilometers type of things with double base propellants, not very this one. And when this one, they've started looking for Russian missiles. Let me add one thing. All the other missiles which we have studied of China, Pakistan and all that, we've been able to look at the images, draw our own conclusion as to what their capabilities are. We have derived their own performance. But in the case of Iranian missiles, except for a little bit on the Safir launch vehicle, we have not been able to go into that detail. So what I am quoting is available in whatever is available in the literature as such. It's not an independent NIAS assessment in depth, so to say. So Scud-B is a highly proliferated weapon system. It's of Russian origin. It's been given to many countries in West Asia, to China a long time back, as well as to Korea and North Korea. So these were sort of available in the market, and Iran essentially shot for the first ones from Libya. And when the Russians became tough with the Libyans for selling them, they went subsequently to Syria. And towards the end, they worked out a deal with North Korea for supplying not only the missiles, but also the manufacturing capability. And they also harvested technical capabilities and expertise of the Chinese and the Russians for promoting their program. I just looking at what the stores today are, the current, I mean, I've not looked at the military balance 2011, but 2010, for example, says there are 12 to 18 launches of Shahab 1 or 2 and 12 launches of Shahab 3. Slightly longer range of a missile of Gadar. The numbers are not known, but the Gadar is, I think, is operational. So is the solid propellant missile Sajil. These are operational. And these are not with the services like the Army, Navy, Air Force, but they come under the Islamic Revolutionary Guard Corps. They control these missiles. In addition, they have the Chinese-made C-802 as well as the HY-2 cruise missiles, but these are essentially anti-ship cruise missiles, range of the order of 200 kilometers. I'm not going to touch much on the cruise missiles during this presentation. It will be mostly on the ballistic missiles. So this is how they have tried to procure and as well as push their own. What they bought from Libya, the standard Scud-B, was Shahab 1. From China, they bought an artillery missile called M7. They renamed it as Tondar 69. They also got from China plant and requirements for the solid propellants. They also got the cruise missiles. Not very sure whether they got the cruise missile technology, but they have definitely brought this one. But in solid propellant, I think they've got the technology also. From North Korea, starting from the Scud-B purchase, they gave them the money to develop the Nodong missile to their longer range requirement and also set up the manufacturing base. So the Shahab 3 and variants have come from there. And from Russia, they've got the guidance components, aerospace quality steel, and perhaps some of the wind tunnel testing, they've got it carried out in the Russian wind tunnels. And obviously training, I think both from China and Russia, they've got some training on how to use these missiles, how to service them, and this one. Sorry for the bloomer in the first column, it's Scuds fired against Iraq, not against Iran. These missiles, I think, when the Iraqis started firing, they didn't have much to retaliate, so they procured these. And Iraqi cities were well within the range of the Scud-Bs, or the Shahab 1s, as they called. But they were not very effective. The accuracy was very limited, and it's about 1 kilometer accuracy at short range. At longer ranges, the accuracy is as much as 5 kilometers, so they really did not hit any target of major value. Even though it's this one. So they exchanged a lot of missiles. You can look at including 77 numbers in 1987. But the major impact in terms of damage or on the outcome of the war, it didn't seem to have much this one. In 85, they got OGAB, which is a prototype of a Chinese 83 missile. This was an artillery missile, but 70 to 100 kilogram payload to about 40 kilometers it could. But what is important is they also set up production facilities at Sirjan, and they tried to make their own missile, which they called Iran 130, where they tried to extend the range, 130 to 200 kilometers. But this is again mostly Iraq-centric, so where exactly this one? And from 87 onwards, the North Korean had made their own indigenized versions of the Scuds, which they called Hwasong 5, and then modified it to Hwasong 6, as they say. And this they bought, and they set up at Isfahan the manufacturing capabilities for this. Now, the Western literature says they set up, but they have not manufactured anything. They're still getting the engine and the other paraphernalia still from North Korea. I am not so sure, but I have a feeling capabilities within Iran are fairly good, mechanical engineering-wise, that they should be able to manufacture this. In 1999, they asked DPRK to carry out range improvements, and the tank diameter from 0.88 millimeters to 1.25 meters was increased. Higher, longer propellant loading it could take, the longer burn time also, so range of 800 to 1000 kilometers they could achieve to carry payloads of the order of 1000 to 750 kg. I have just put in the reverse order because 1,000 kg will go to a shorter range of 800 kilometers. With 750 kg payload, you can go to a longer range. Now, the importance, as I see, of 1,000 kg is maybe you can fit in a 1,000 kg payload this one a nuclear warhead. It is doable by most countries. But this range of 800 kilometers falls far short of reaching Israel. It touches various countries, but it does not touch Israel, so you need to modify that. So the Iranians went ahead modifying the airframe of Shahab 3 very much. Instead of using steel for the airframe, they started using aluminum alloy. They cut down the inert weights, they slightly increased the length and increased the propellant loading, and with the result, with Ghadar, they could touch a range of 1500 kilometers, which was sort of all it. You could kiss Israel fairly comfortably. They used this Ghadar missile. Of course, there's one more thing called Kavashgar. I can't make out what exactly is the change they have made. They made a launch vehicle also, Safir. I'll be touched this one. What, as compared to many other countries, they could reach orbit. Maybe a very small payload, but with just two stages, they managed to reach orbit. These were all liquid-based systems, and liquid systems take longer time to prepare. They are more messy, and fabrication-wise also, they are more involved. So this is the time, I think, they went into the solid rockets, and they built a very large system called Sejil. And in large size from the artillery and a shorter range, this one with composite propellant, I think they have managed to achieve certain capability in this also. Ambassador Singh in his introductory remarks said something about the re-entry vehicle. I think I must mention here, the one is the aerodynamic shape. The second thing is the material required for the re-entry. This one, the re-entry thermal loads, how do you protect the thermal protection material to protect the inner elements of the re-entry vehicle. This, it appears to me, the Iranians have managed to master the re-entry technology, at least in terms of materials, and looking at the aerodynamic shape, maybe in the aerodynamics also. And if they've been able to test out some of these things in the Russian tunnels at Mach 4 to 6, I think they would have had fairly good results available from which they should be able to put things together. This is, I'm more or less repeating in a summed up fashion what exactly is this one. So it is, if you look, the Egyptians were the first, the DPRK bought the Scuds from Egypt, not directly from Russia to start with. Reverse engineered it and called it Fasong. They, in the meantime, they got technical assistance from both China and this one. Improved variant 6 Cut C, which they sold to all these countries. And scaled up Hwasong to achieve a range of 1500 km, which they called Nodong. And they had these cooperative development arrangements against nuclear technology with Pakistan and against petrodollars with Iran. So they sort of made it happen. This just shows the similarity between Nodong and this one. If you look at the fin shapes are identical, the flame length and the flame, this one is this one. The control system, they use a jetwing control system. They are also identical. The warhead is more or less the same. So it sort of stands out, many of this one, between Gauri of Pakistan, Shahab 3 and the Nodong. You can very, very clearly see the imagery similarities. So this is the route which for increasing the range. So existing missiles from Shahab 2, they went to Shahab 3 with essentially improvements done by DPRK in terms of diameter, extra propellant loading, modification in the airframe to reach Ghadar, and further this one to Kashgar to reach a 2,000 kilometer type of range. So this one. So these are new technology elements which they have to push in if they want to go to this one, and hopefully they have the technology elements with them. Whether they have the capability to put them together, integrate, that is to be seen. So these are the basic technology improvements they have done. There were separate tanks for the oxidizer and fuel in the Shahab Scud B or the Shahab 1 and 2. They made it what they call the integrated, this one, so they saved this space. They could manage to load more propellant. This became Scud C in this one. And these are some of the parameters of the range that we have given, as well as you can see the diameter has gone from 0.88 to 1.25, the propellant mass has gone from 3.8 to as much as 13.7, and they've got this type of range improvements that they have managed today. There's some, again, WikiLeaks data. Iran may have procured 19 BM-25 missiles. This is a submarine-launched ballistic missile of Russian origin, liquid propellant, which is obsolete because hardly anybody uses liquid propulsion systems for submarine launch from safety considerations. But they managed to get it as one WikiLeaks, this one. The missile has a range of 1,800 kilometers. Now, whether this the Western feeling of whether these people have the total missile system they have procured or components they have procured, not very clear, but Western media is trying to rubbish things. They have got the total system, they may have procured some components is what they say. But whatever it is, from the Iranian media and press, we are unable to see any corroborative evidence of this missile or any test or a display of it in the parades and so on. In case it is there, it could form a powerful booster for the Safir launch vehicle. In the solid propellant missiles, these were the missiles they had earlier, having the OGAB and they slightly modified in this one. These are all, as you can see, very short-range missiles. They're not very large range. They've managed slightly here. I think these are the ones where from the low-energy propellant systems, they've gone into the composite solid propellants, and perhaps this is where the plant chemicals, materials, and the technology which the Chinese may have given may have helped in making these into the longer range missiles. The Sejil is the biggest they have, and this also they have tested, they've already flown. This is a two-stage system. Both stages are of identical diameter. The nose cone shape or the re-entry vehicle shape, as you can see, has gone into a lot of aerodynamic modification, and it has got the thermal protection system, as I was mentioning. As I see, this is, as far as the control system goes, they seem to have derived the same systems from the liquid engines, whatever they got from the Scud series, because they also have the same jetway and control system. They have not gone into the modern system of flex nozzle and things like that, but seems to do the job. In terms of steering, stage separation and all that, these things, they seem to have put the retro thrusters for each thing. So that means they have managed how to separate and the two stages. This sort of thing seems obvious. And rest is in terms of the fabrication technology and things like that. Not much input is available with regard to the inner designs, but I think looking at the overall, the capability seems to have been established. This is a small view of where exactly this one. So bulk of their solid propellant production facilities seem to be in the Senman region, where they have the launch range also. They have some other, this one, and Isfahan is the other liquid propellant based this one. There's a missile production support facility in Shiraz. Others are all bases for various other purposes. So on February 2009, they managed to launch a 27 kg payload into orbit. What I find for a first launch very peculiar, and therefore some sort of a capability demonstration, is they did a nighttime launch. Very few people, I think, in their first launch will venture to try to do a nighttime launch, but they did this. Second thing is they managed to achieve orbit in two stages. There's a booster stage and the second stage went into orbit. Actually, when we did an assessment of this launch vehicle, you know, you require a certain orbital injection velocity. We felt, looking at the size and all that, they would have perhaps had a third stage. And with three stages, it was very comfortable to achieve the orbit. But when we looked for, were there any issue of NOTAMs, that is notice to airmen, notice to mariners for the range safety considerations, where the second stage is going to impact, we found no evidence of it, at least. And there was no public notices available. And we had a confirmation from an American think tank person saying that the signatures which NORAD has obtained from there, this one, shows the second stage's diameter was same as about 1.25 meter type of object is in orbit along with the satellite. So I think this is the major capability they have, this one. The rest is all about the satellite and the this one. And this is the sort of route, Shah 3 to Ghadar 1. So this formed the booster stage, so which did seem to have really taken this to a fairly large stage, so that with the second stage they could achieve orbital velocities of the order of about 7.6 kilometers per second, which is required. There are some close-up views of the satellite launch vehicle with all the thermal protection system, the second stage, and the other details. I don't think I'm going to get into details of this. But I just put it because starting from the ground infrastructure with regard to servicing platforms onwards, everything has been thought of. This may be a cooling system for the satellite itself. There are umbilicals running for servicing the electrical and other this one. So the total engineering as we do in a launch vehicle system is fairly well considered and matched. As just out of curiosity, I started looking at what was the mass of the first satellite launched by various other countries. And from that angle, these people may have done it as late as 2009. But if you raise the satellite mass, they're not very badly off. Soviet Union, 2083 kg, Sputnik. Americans did even less, only 14 kg. The French had a 42 kg satellite. Osumi was 24 kg. China, 173 kg. It did nothing but saying that the East is red, it sank. UK, 66. India, 35 kg. So it is not too bad, I should say, as an effort for this one. And India, we did this in a four-stage vehicle, and these people managed to do in a two-stage vehicle. So it just shows a good amount of technical assimilation and capability is there. So this, I've already, this one, so if just, therefore, after that, they've continued with their space program, and up to that, I think they should have launched the fourth satellite. So February, they launched Omid, they launched Rasad on 17th June 2011, Navid on 33rd of February 2012, so 1 year apart. This, there was a newspaper clipping saying that they're launching Fajr. This was supposed to be a remote sensing satellite on 23rd May 2012, but I have not seen the confirmatory saying that it is already launched. But they seem to have some sort of this one. I think one of these carried some animals also on a ballistic trajectory. So this I just, we just did this, from the images try to fix up the lengths and things of that variety. So the total length came to 20.9 meters and about 16 to 17 as the length to diameter ratio. And if you just look at the type of infrastructure they've used for hoisting and all that, as I was mentioning, the total infrastructure for supporting such a launch is totally seems to be in place. Electric connection, hoisting this one, servicing, all requirements seem to be in place. So obviously they have the, this is the type of range. Good part of India is covered with this. Israel, Georgia, East Europe, this one. So you can look at this. If Safir launch vehicle, instead of going into orbit, you want to convert to a missile, about 2,400, 2,500 kilometer type of range is comfortably possible. But if you put a 1,000 kg payload, how much it will be, if we are not really computed. As it is, we just looked at. This is on the other European side. So I was just looking at what type of technologies they have managed. Perhaps they could have this one. This is essentially, I guess. So solid and liquid propellant missile technology. No doubt in the liquid propellants as such, they are still using low energy systems. This is the AK-27 and the It's still red fumic nitric acid based system. They can still go for earth storable. UDMH N204 systems are available. It's not very much difficult either to procure these propellants from friends like China and other places or manufacture it themselves. It's not very this one. Now, if you have one liquid engine, it's not difficult to put three or four of them together, cluster, pump it, and have a single tank for feeding them. I think that technology really should not be very much difficult for them. They already have a pumping system, so they can modify it. They obviously seem to have the materials, both for the motor as well as the liquid rocket tankage systems, but also for the re-entry vehicle. All the ordnance systems seem to be in place. You require the ordnance systems for ignition, for stage separation, for retro purposes. Those all seem to be there. Rocket staging, control and guidance. Instrumentation, telemetry tracking, management. Now, they are perhaps one of the few countries or perhaps the only countries who have had a missile war experience. The number of missiles they've exchanged with Iran, this one. When I started looking at which other country has this type of a missile exchange program who have benefited from learning, America and all that, Iraq was all one-sided totally. So essentially, this is the one set, perhaps they've learned some lessons. But unfortunately, these things are not in the open. I don't know whether somebody has written some study on that. I have not come across. So these capabilities are very much there. And I thought, let me see where exactly, how do they compare with Pakistan? Pakistan has solid propellant missiles. Their Shaheen 2, in our assessment, is of the order of 1,200 kilometers range with a 1,200 kg payload. It may be higher if you use a 700 kg. But Sejil is 2,000 kilometers range. If you take the liquid propellant, they also procured from North Korea, Pakistan, but they don't seem to have set up a manufacturing capability of their own. Whereas these people are now in a position perhaps to design, manufacture, and perhaps cluster the engines, and because they have gone into the launch vehicle, this one also. Cruise missiles, Pakistan seems to be better. These people don't seem to have done much there. Satellite launch, Pakistan has not a demonstrated capability. And Iran has demonstrated a small satellite launch capability. And of course, nuclear weapon capabilities are established as far as Pakistan and Iran. That's what we are debating right now. So in conclusion, I just want to say, having realized the importance of long-range missiles as part of the Iran-Iraq war, they have managed to develop their own, this one. Early efforts were procurement from Libya, Syria, and DPRK. Simultaneously, they have set up their own manufacturing base. No doubt, they've got received technology, support, help, as well as equipment and chemicals from China, technology help from Russia. And they are good from solid rocket propellants, from artillery to long-range missiles. They have this one. Manufacturing base in all these areas they have established. And they seem to have a fairly good capability to assimilate the technology, scale it up, and this perhaps is indigenous. And they have demonstrated an achievement of satellite launch capability. And I think there is adequate scope for technological innovation. If they want to do it, perhaps they can do it. Thank you.
One observation. You mentioned amongst the countries to whom DPRK gave the missiles, you said UAE, perhaps Saudi Arabia.
Okay.
It should be Saudi Arabia, because the Saudis were sitting on a huge amount of missiles.
Right, I see.
And there's always been a question mark that who was going to give them the device to put on them. Is there an arrangement between Pakistan and Saudi Arabia? UAE, I don't think, has those.
Okay. I'll make a note on that.
Yeah. And it's very interesting the way you linked up all the details of how the technology has flown from one country to the next. It's almost like avian flu. You know, it gestates and then goes to the next one and then next one, and somebody improves it. And each time in the passing, it's got improved. Interesting thing will be any possible link between Pakistan and Iran in the future. We don't know. Because one seems to have the capability for the space and longer range missiles, and the other seems to have the device.
Right.
So it'll be interesting to see, if any exchange ever in the future. It can't be ruled out because the exchange began between them at the beginning.
That's right.
And whether it can be it. So with this, we will not restrict it to. I think it can be comment or question or whatever there'll be. Yes, please go ahead.
Rajan, just a suggestion. Capabilities is fine. If you look at the future, what they are going to develop, perhaps it's worthwhile overlaying on this. What is their material R&D capability?
Okay.
Whether it's high energy or fibers, the devices or the electronics. I think if you overlay them, they will know whether you will have a indigenous capability or it's always going to depend on imports. Because this is a control on guidance and propulsion.
Yeah. Those areas we're not really researched for, that we need to do something
on it. If you look at a survey of that and then overlay on this, perhaps you'll get a better idea of where they are going to go.
I think bugbear definitely is in the guidance system, the inertial navigation systems and all that, how capable, and this one, I think that's worthwhile to check on that.
Do we know whether they have hypersonic test facilities?
I have not really looked at what are their university capabilities and test facilities as such. So that's one area we need to look at further. We've not done any exploration on that.
I think generally what you were saying was that even the tunnel, testing in the tunnel all might have been done by the Russians.
There we are.
So there would be some exchanges, because otherwise American and Israelis are watching so carefully what happens in Iran. Generally, Iranian behavior will be that because the focus is on the nuclear issue, they would do this quietly.
Quietly they'll do it.
And in company, rather than ostensibly with the facilities visible and the capabilities developing.
Could you once again just trace the kind of family history of that 2,400 kilometer missile? Because all the others are of one type. This one sort of sticks out as one long-range missile. How did it come from? What, pure technology? Just technology transfer? There was no missile transferred at all?
One is the Scud C, which the DPRK made.
Which is 1,200 kilometers.
Yeah, but then you see they increased the diameter from 0.88 to 1.25. The tank diameter became higher also. So now it could contain more propellant. Even though the same low energy propellant, it could contain more propellant and it burned for almost 20 seconds longer. So that gave them the higher reach. Then they modified the airframe by discarding the steel, they're replacing the steel with aluminum alloy. The structural mass, the structural inerts, they cut down a lot. So what else they've cut down? I mean, if you ask me, I mean, I don't have really the structural factor, what is the improvement, but this is what the literature seems to indicate. These are the two areas. They reduce the inert mass, they increase the energetic propellant mass into it, which has helped them to increase the range.
So what would be the motivation again, 1,500 to 1,400 kilometers?
That would be, I mean, this is a guess from the Safir launch vehicle. If you convert to a two-stage missile, that will be the type of this one. But I added a rider to it. We have not really done payload. That with a 1,000 kg payload, how much it will go. Purely instead of going into orbit, it goes how far. That was the calculation. It's not exactly correct.
No, space program is it's dual use. All over the world, it's been developed that way as a dual use technology. We've done the same. Everyone does the same to bypass the MTCR. But essentially, the difference between, say, DPRK, Pakistan, and Iran is the three which are sort of feeding it. Here is knowledge bases there. Iran is a knowledge base. Iran is not requiring to get funds clandestinely. It had while, particularly when while price is up, that is when surplus funds are available. And probably you'll see if somebody does a correlation between spurts in development of these technologies and the oil price going up, there may be a parallelism.
Okay.
There'll be a scaling back when the oil price is down and scaling up when the oil. So someone can probably look at the oil price and see how movement of this thing is there. Whereas the other two are diverting funds and doing it from their development programs or stealing, or in case of Pakistan, utilizing Saudi Arabia and UAE as funders for their program, etc., and then sharing it. And for DPRK, it's just, as it is said, it's a country attached to an army. So essentially, they can do what they want. Yeah. Go ahead.
This is something that, of course, you know very well. The routing has been in reverse. They develop missiles first and launch vehicles afterwards. Here it's, I mean, for us and so on, and many others, it's been in the other direction. And
not for many others, only us and Japan. The only two countries we can think of.
Sorry?
Only Japan and India, we started a civilian program first and then direct.
Right. Now the question there is, I agree. The point there is, why didn't they go this route rather than the other route? The standard non-P5 route, if you like.
I don't know. I think this brings it. If you have a launch capability, even though the Americans, for example, the Korean launch, they called it a missile, the satellite launch attempt, they call it a missile. But here they have not, somehow, the Americans still they did not call the Safir into a missile, as a missile. This gives them certain legitimacy. I am, after all, doing a satellite launch for a very peaceful purpose, either for remote sensing, for my own development.
Why did the legitimacy come after the illegitimacy? Rather, it's usually the other way around.
Maybe the compulsions.
Yeah.
That's what he said. The missile systems development was based in Iran-Iraq war. And I know when you talk to people in Tehran, when first time Tehran came within range, it used to, not so much damage was done as the panic was created.
Okay.
because Saddam Hussein will generally launch one in the direction of Tehran, not at a particular target. And then this randomness of this missile, you didn't know, probably that way, an American missile, you're not that scared of, you know, it's going for the president's office or building. But this one could come at anybody. It was a Russian roulette. So the whole city was in panic because you didn't know where it will come and hit.
One comment on Pakistan and Iran. My hunch is that there's not much of love lost between Pakistan and Iran in this area, missiles. For one, Pakistan desires, gets a lot of funding from Saudi Arabia, okay, which is a kind of a rank opposite of a relationship with Iran. That's number one. And there is sufficient evidence, I won't say full-fledged, that close enough to $3 to $5 billion have been given by Saudi Arabia to Pakistan in pursuit of its programs. Don't call it by any name. You do whatever you want, you get the money. So in terms of Iran itself, unlikely to be any collaboration because political rivalry apart, there are religions at clash.
My only concern is that don't forget that the 82 AQ Khan Walmart was functioning with the same support from Saudi Arabia and UAE. I'm never able to explain why the Pakistani military and Zia, at that stage, it wasn't AQ Khan by himself. There is evidence. They've tried saving the military, but there is evidence because it was Rafsanjani who had approached them and there was a political clearance. Why AQ Khan was allowed to pander? One excuse is he was giving hand-me-downs and non-functional P1 centrifuges and getting money out of them. Or was it an Islamic thing? Because Zia was looking at a larger Islamic thing. You never know where Pakistani interests shift from one to the other. We don't know. If US starts pressing Pakistan the way they're going, in the direction they're going, and tomorrow you never know, Pakistan's seen as a state which needs to be disarmed. Supposing there's a dirty bomb that goes up somewhere, then there will be a global demand to disarm Pakistan as far as the nuclear devices are concerned. How the convergences then take place between different states, I won't rule out anything.
My theory would be fairly straightforward. A, unlikely any collaboration between Pakistan and Iran ruled out. Number two, Pakistan certainly depends via Saudi Arabia for funding of its various programs. So the likelihood of a tie-up or collaboration between these two, to me, looks unlikely.
Just a very small clarification. You know, this last launch, 23rd Fajr, that you mentioned, there was a news item which has been postponed inexplicably, the Iranian Space Agency, and it says possibly to March 2013. Without any basis, I would guess this could be purely tactical with reference to the current negotiations.
Possible.
We assume there's total clarity. Yeah. Thank you very much.